after about 9 or 10 months, I called up Lonnie Turner and Gary Malibur and said, hey, you know, I've got about 25 songs I want to cut. Just the three of us, and we'll go in and we'll just cut these basic tracks. Met Lonnie in San Francisco. Gary was the kind of guy that if you were a producer and had to make a pop album, you'll get Gary Malibur on drums because we got to fix this track, you know. That was my preferred kind of band, was a guitar, bass, and drums. I just loved it.
Okay, rolling.
Okay. Count it. One, two.
And so we went into CBS and cut all the basic tracks for both albums, both Fly Like an Eagle and Book of Dreams. And in 11 days, we were doing about four tunes a day. And then I did all the vocals and all the guitar work over the next year at home.
Okay, if everybody's ready, if all the tapes are rolling, let's go with Steve Miller.
We're from the ghetto, y'all.
Started out as a song about the ghetto. We were, you know, sort of beginning to get out of the Vietnam War, and people were beginning to kind of look back into cities. And it sort of developed over time. You know, I didn't want to write a real preachy tune. I wanted to, you know, try and find a solution to things. And so, very young, you know, touring, playing 250 cities. A year playing every night someplace. It took about 3 years for it to all settle into place and become what it is now. I recorded that song 3 different times. And you know, that means we like went in the studio, we spent a lot of money, we spent a lot of time, we brought a lot of people in, recorded it, and went, It was very difficult because it was such a great jam to me. We really enjoy playing this song, so, you know, 30 minutes, fine.
What about the children, y'all?
We played it all the time, and it just grew, you know. Sing new verses, make up verses while we were playing on the stage. Hard song to capture that feeling. You know, it's easy when you play it live. But to put it on a record and then, you know, cut it down to 3 minutes and 20 seconds and put it on the radio and have it, you know, what is that? And eventually it all ended up in my living room with me and my tape recorder and this rhythm track, trying them different ways. One of the things about Fly Like an Eagle is we would play the song. There'd always be a mirror ball. It would always be, you know, in a big ballroom with lights and stuff, and that added a lot to the atmosphere. And without that atmosphere, it didn't feel right. So I had recorded it, I had it all together, and the last day after it was mixed, I came in with my synth that I had. I had this little, very cheap little synthesizer, and I hooked it up to my Echoplex, and I said, I want to put some effects and some things on this. And that's when I did the space intro and did all these things. And in about 8 minutes, did the electronic stuff and put that on there. All right, so now it's on the tape, and I'm going, yeah, this is working. So then when Gaines and I are mixing it, we had to get another piece of tape. And while we were playing that, we found that the bulk erase tape had a sound on it, and that's the little beep, beep, beep. That's it, it's done. You know? I could fly like an eagle the entire album in 17 hours. We were making singles for AM radio that were mono and stereo for FM radio. We were able to capture both mediums at the same time. Finally, everybody understood that, yeah, you know, people want to hear stereo. You know, they got stereos in their cars now. And we did a quad mix too. You know, so we were doing stereo mixes and quad, you know, panning like this and, you know, I'm like, stars, the moon and the sun. You decide which was on Fly Like an Eagle and which was on Book of Eagles? Well, you know, it was a really good problem to have. There was a lot of good music, and I love putting puzzles together, and I love segueing music. I've always been a fan of albums that just flow, you know. I mean, there were times when everything was on one record and it was like, you know, a pyramid of chocolate or something. It was just, you know, too much. And over a period of time, I spent a lot of time segueing and putting different pieces of music together. And by taking it and spreading it out over two albums, I was able to use other kinds of music that you normally wouldn't be able to put on an album. You know, I had some slow 12-string blues, I had some jazz, I had some electronic music, I had these segues and things. And it got more and more interesting, you know, as they started spreading it out.
Sweet Mary came walking up to me.
James is just one of the great, you know, Delta harmonica players. I mean, he's just phenomenal. And we did lots of shows together. James Cotton Band and the Steve Miller Band did a ton of shows in the 60s and early 70s. Sweet Marie is a tune that I said, I got this little tune I want to do, you know, and I started playing the 12 string. And he just picked up that old harp and started playing it, and we recorded it, and that was one of those pieces that by spreading all the songs out between the two albums, that then you're able to put something like that on a pop record and not have it, you know, go, well, that's blues, we're never really gonna listen to that.
Yeah.
I grew up in Texas where pop music was blues. Jimmy Reed tunes, Little Walter, Muddy Waters, Howlin' Wolf were all top 10 AM hit singles in Texas. I was just this little kid in a house full of music all the time, full of great jazz, gospel music, blues, standards, pop music, you know, just everything, and musicians. Pop had a Magna Quarter. It was a really good professional recorder, and there were very few of them. I mean, radio stations had them, and that was about it. And he went down to this club where Les Paul and Mary Ford were rehearsing their act. My dad said, hey, I've got a tape recorder. You mind if I come down and record you? And Les said, no, that'd be great. Bring it down. And they became really good friends. So Les started coming over to the house all the time. Next thing I knew, I was 9 years old, and T-Bone Walker showed up at the house to hang out with my dad and play some guitar. And that was my basic, you know, Les taught me the chords. T-Bone taught me how to play lead, what lead guitar was. T-Bone's